व्यज्यमानात्मपौरुषौ व्यज्यमानात्मपौरुषौ ववृधाते अश्म सारेण ववृधाते अश्म सारेण ववृधाते अश्म सारेण कायेन अद्रिपति इव कायेनाद्रिपति इव कायेनाद्रिपति इव तावादिदैत्यौ सहसा व्यज्यमानात्मपौरुषौ ववृधाते स्म सारेण कायेनाद्रिपति इव तावादिदैत्यौ सहसा व्यज्यमानात्मपौरुषौ ववृधाते स्म सारेण कायेनाद्रिपति इव तौ दोस्तु आदि दैत्यौ डीमन्स इन द बिगिनिंग ऑफ क्रिएशन सहसा क्विकली व्यज्यमान बीइंग मैनिफेस्ट आत्मा ओन पौरुषौ प्रावस ववृधाते ग्रु अश्मसारेण स्टील लाइक कायेन विथ बॉडीली फ्रेम्स अद्रिपति टू ग्रेट माउंटेन्स इव लाइक ट्रांसलेशन एंड परपोर्ट बाय डिवाइन ग्रेस श्रील प्रभुपाद दीज टू डीमंस हू अपियर्ड इन एंशियंट टाइम्स सून बिगैन टू एग्जिबिट अनकॉमन बॉडीली फीचर्स दे हैड स्टील लाइक फ्रेम्स विच बिगैन टू ग्रो जस्ट लाइक टू ग्रेट माउंटेन्स Kindly repeat, these two demons who appeared in ancient times soon began to exhibit uncommon bodily features. They had steel-like frames which began to grow just like two great mountains. Purport by His Divine Grace Srila Prabhupada. There are two classes of men in the world. One is called the demon and the other is called the demigod. The demigods concern themselves with the spiritual upliftment of human society, whereas the demons are concerned with physical and material upliftment. The two demons born of Diti began to make their bodies as strong as iron frames, and they were so tall that they seemed to touch outer space. They were decorated with valuable ornaments and they thought that this was a success in life. Originally, it was planned that Jaya and Vijaya, the two doorkeepers of Vaikuntha, were to take birth in this material world, where, by the curse of the sages, they were to play the part of always being angry with the Supreme Personality of Godhead. As demoniac persons, they became so angry that they were not concerned with the Supreme Personality of Godhead, but simply with physical comforts and physical upliftment. Thus ends the Bhaktivedanta purport. Om Ajnana Timirandasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshurunmilitam Yena Tasmai Sri Gurave Namaha Namavom Vishnu Padaya Krishna Preshthaya Bhutale Srimate Bhaktivedanta Swaminitinamine Namaste Saraswate Deve Gauravani Pracharine Nirvishesha Shunyavadi Paschatya Deshatarine Jai Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhara Shri Vasadi Gaura Bhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama 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 Hare Hare Mukam Karoti Vachalam Pangum Langhayate Girim Yat Kripatam Hammande Shri Gurum Dinataranam. So here we are seeing a nice description of how the Hiranyaksha and Hiranyakashipu after birth, how they grew up, what kind of lifestyle they had. It reminds me very much of my college days. In college, when we used to go to class, during the morning times, the college had a gym. We all friends would go together to the gym, do bench press, lift dumbbells, do parallel bars, you know, the whole works. The idea was that we should develop frames as tall as mountains and we should have steel-like bodies, just like you will see in all these Bollywood movies, isn't it? So, especially if you see film actors, they have very strong bodies, lot of muscles and, you know, six-pack or 8-pack abs and whatnot and all those kind of things, because that is considered the success of life. And we were also enamored by those pictures of these stars, cine stars, and we would all go and work out trying to develop our bodies like that. Of course, I never could develop a body like that. I always remained quite lean, although I had a lot of desire to be like that. But when I came to Krishna consciousness and understood of all this, all that fizzled away, all those desires fizzled away. So, what is being told here is, as Prabhupada is mentioning here, there are two classes of men. In the Padma Purana it is mentioned, Dvau Bhuta Sargau Loke Asmin Daiva Asura Evacha Vishnu Bhaktaha Smrito Daiva Asurastad Viparyayaha. That broadly speaking, there are two classes of human beings within this material universe. Dvau Bhuta Sargau Loke Asmin, in this loka, in this world, in this material manifestation, Dvau, there are two Bhuta Sargau, there are two kinds of living entities. What are those two kinds of living entities? Vishnu Bhaktaha Smrito Daivaha. One class of people are called Daiva. Daiva are godly people. They are not God, but they are godly. Who are godly? Vishnu Bhaktaha. Those who are devotees of Vishnu or Krishna, they are godly people, Daivaha. And Asurastad Viparyaya. Those who are Viparyaya, those who are antagonistic towards Vishnu, they are called Asura. So these are the two broad classification of people who exist in this material universe. Now, what is the difference between these two? Prabhupada mentions that both the devotees and the asuras, both of them are very conscientious. Conscientious means they work according to their conscience. They want all their surroundings to be clean. They are very concerned about the material nature, about environment, global warming, how the economy is improving, how people should not suffer, all people should have equal rights. You know, all these kind of thoughts are there, you will find, even amongst devotees as well as amongst the asuras also. But then, devotees think people should not suffer, we should work for the welfare of the people, we should not exploit material nature. These kind of thoughts devotees also have. when asuras, when they think of these things, environment should be protected, the people should not suffer, etc., they think from the perspective of increasing our material sense gratification. When devotees of Vishnu, they think of the benefit of the people, how people should not suffer, they are thinking not about their material sense gratification, but they are thinking how they can be eternally liberated from this cycle of birth and death, and in this way they can become free from material distress. The devotees are thinking that we should not exploit material nature. Why? Not for our sense gratification, but for the satisfaction of Vishnu or Krishna. So the purpose between the activities of a devotee and an asura are completely different, although externally it might seem like both are doing similar kinds of activities. A karmi or a person who is an asura, he may undertake large scale feeding of lot of people. What is his intention? People's hunger should be mitigated. People should not suffer for want of food. A devotee also may undertake large scale distribution of food. What is his thinking? His thinking is Krishna's prasadam should reach everyone, irrespective of whether he is hungry, not hungry, he is materially very rich, materially very poor. Why? Because the devotee is thinking by giving this prasadam to that person will get eternally benefited. So naturally a devotee also feels compassion towards a person who is hungry, who is very poor, who is struggling, who is malnourished and all these kind of people. At the same time, a devotee also thinks that this is Krishna's kingdom, he is Krishna's child, why is he suffering like this? Let me give him Krishna prasadam and Krishna will take care of him. This is a devotee's thinking. Whereas a karmi, an asura, what he thinks is, I am doing benefit for the person, I am helping him. The sense of doership is very strongly present in an asura, which is not there in a Vaishnava. So in this material world, these kind of asuras, their whole focus, their consciousness is totally centered upon their material sense gratification, and they think of various ways and means of materially adjusting things so that they can increase their sense gratification and they can live permanently within this material world. Whereas a devotee is thinking how to reduce sense gratification and how to get out of this material world. So because of this mentality of exploitation of material nature and of their desire to enhance and increase unlimited, unrestrictedly their sense enjoyment, these demons have a tendency to develop their bodies very strongly. They want to possess very strong bodies so that they can withstand the forces of nature and they can beat old age, disease and death. This is their whole focus. So this kind of mentality of an asura comes because of his strong desire to control material nature, strong desire to control other living entities, strong desire to lord it over material nature and other living entities. So actually, if you see, this material universe is permeated completely by this sense of control. So this material universe itself, it is permeated by the sense of control, because this material universe is sustained by Krishna's omniscient potency, by his all-pervasive feature. So the whole material universe its existence is being sustained by Krishna's Paramatma feature, which is the all-pervasive feature. So the all-pervasiveness of Krishna gives him knowledge about everything that is happening, directly as well as indirectly. And therefore, knowledge, as they say, is power. You get the power to control by knowing, by having knowledge. If you don't know something about an object, you cannot control that object. That is why the scientists are also constantly researching, trying to increase their understanding of how this material world works. Because the more they know how the material world works, what are the laws which are governing this material world, they can exploit it, they can control it and enhance their sense gratification. So this whole material universe is permeated with that sense of control. And because the sense of control is very prominent in this material world, therefore the asuras are also trying to control everything. But it is not possible for them to control, because all control is vested within the hands of Kshirodaka Sai Vishnu or the Paramatma, because he is pervading every atom as well as every universe. Andantarastham paramanu chayantarastham. Every universe as well as every atom within the universe is also pervaded by the Paramatma. And therefore, he is omniscient. He knows everything directly and indirectly of what is happening within this material universe at every second, and he is controlling everything. And that is why we say, without his will, without Krishna's will, without the Paramatma's will, not even a blade of grass moves. That means what? The Lord is controlling this whole material universe, and that is what is sustaining this material universe. Now, when you take up the Vaikuntha Dhamma, Hari Dhamma, this material universe is called Devi Dhamma. Why? Because it is controlled by Durga Devi. When you take up Hari Dhamma, Vaikuntha Dhamma, there is no need to control all the living entities, because all the living entities there are already surrendered to Vishnu. Only surrendered souls you will find in Vaikuntha. So there Vaikuntha is, Vaikuntha Dhamma or Hari Dhamma is sustained by Vishnu's Aishwarya potency, by his Shad Aishwarya, by his opulences. What are the opulences? As Parashara Muni has said, Aishwaryasya Samagrasya Viryasya Yachasah Shriyoho Jnana Vairagyasya Shannam Bhagamitim Gana. The beauty of Narayana, his wealth, his strength or his power, his knowledge, his fame, his renunciation, all these constitute the six opulences of Mahavishnu or of Narayana. And this opulence, this Shada Aishwarya of Narayana, is what sustains Haridhama. And when it comes to Goloka, what is it that sustains Goloka Dhamma? Goloka Dhamma is not sustained by either his all-pervasive feature. Why? Because the Paramatma is there only in this material universe. Paramatma is not there in the spiritual world. He is not there in Goloka Dhamma. Nor is Krishna engaged in displaying his six opulences in all his grandeur in Vaikuntha, like in the Vaikuntha Dhamma. So what is it that sustains Goloka Vrindavan? Karuna Nikuramba Komale Madura Ishwarya Vishesha Shalini. So about Goloka Vrindavan, it is described, because of the Krishna's Karuna, Karuna Nikuramba Komale, Vrindavan is very soft. Everything about Sri Vrindavan Dham you'll find is very mridu, is very komala. And another feature of the Goloka Vrindavan is Madhuraishwarya Vishesha Shalini. The Vishesha Shalini, the Vishesha, the very special feature which is there in Goloka, which is not to be found even in Vaikuntha, is the Madhuraishwarya, the opulence of the conjugal love of Krishna. And this Madhurya Prema of Krishna is what sustains Goloka Dhamma. And that's where you will see the sweetness of Krishna's love is dripping from every devotee in Goloka Vrindavan. Every Brajavasi is imbued with such sweet love for Krishna. Whether you take Yashodamai, whether you take Nanda Maharaj, whether you take Madhumangala, whether you take Sri Dhamma, whether you take the Gopis, all of them have such sweet love for Krishna, which you will not find in any other universe, whether it is Vaikuntha, or whether it is Haridhama or Devi Dhamma, you cannot find this. This is the unique feature of Goloka Vrindavan. And why all the Brajavasis, the devotees who are in Goloka Vrindavan, are imbued with such sweet love for Krishna? because Krishna himself is so sweet. Krishna's sweetness is unparalleled. Shri Krishna Balarama ki. Krishna's sweetness cannot be matched even by Narayana. Krishna is so sweet that even Narayana becomes attracted to him. When Krishna was there in this planet 5000 years ago, Krishna was ruling over Dwaraka. So in Dwaraka, what happened was that once a Brahmana, he used to live in Dwaraka, his wife delivered a child. But unfortunately, as soon as the child was delivered, it died. So the Brahmana came to the Dwaraka palace and he condemned all the Yadu dynasty kings, saying that in the presence of the father, how is the son dying? Because in the olden times, the king used to be responsible to ensure that there were no untimely deaths within the kingdom. People could die only of old age out of natural causes. If any of the citizen dies in his youth, when his father is still living, that means the king has become adharmic. So then the king is no longer fit to rule. So the Brahmana came here and accused all the Yadu kings in front of Krishna, Balaram, Ugrasena. He criticized all of them. What is this? You are all big people sitting here, and in front of you my son is dying. How is it possible? That means you are doing some adharma. He criticized, and Krishna was smiling and kept quiet. Then in due course of time, the Brahmana's wife gave birth to a second child, and even that child died upon birth. Again he came to the court of Dwaraka and he criticized all the kings of the Yadu dynasty, and he went back. And this happened again and again and again. Like this it happened 8 times. And then the 9th time also the child died upon birth. So the Brahmana came and very bitterly he criticized all the Yadava kings. Krishna, Balarama, Pradyumna, everybody he criticized. So that 9th time, Arjuna happened to be there. And when Arjuna heard this, he got shocked. And all the Yadu kings, they had become used to it, because this is not the first time it is happening. Again and again it is happening, and Krishna is keeping quiet, so they are also keeping quiet. But Arjuna got shocked. What is this? He is coming and criticizing all the kings. So he got up and told the Brahmana, "Don't worry, I am there. Please don't think that Kshatriyas are not there to protect the Brahmanas. I am there. I'll give you all protection. I'll see that your next child doesn't die." So in due course of time, the Brahmana said, "Okay, all big kings, personalities, Pradyumna, Asamba, Aniruddha, Balarama himself, Krishna himself are sitting here. They are not saying anything. You are saying you will protect my child. How is it possible?" Arjuna said, no, I've got Pashupata from Lord Shiva. I've defeated even Lord Shiva. I am this, I am that, and all those kind of things he started telling about himself. So he said, "Don't worry, I will protect. And if I am not able to protect your child, then I'll give up my life." So Arjuna took this vow. So then Brahmana said, "Okay, if you are ready to protect, I am fine." So then in due course of time, the Brahmana's wife, the time came for the Brahmana's wife to deliver the 10th child. So immediately the Brahmana called Arjuna. Arjuna, till then he was staying in Dwaraka only. He did not go back to Indraprastha. Why? Because of his promise that he would protect this Brahmana's child. So immediately Arjuna took up all his bow, arrow and all, and went to the Brahmana's house, and then he started shooting arrows for protection. He invoked the Pashupata Astra, everything, so that any enemy comes, the arrow would kill all of them. And then the child was born, and as soon as the child was born, what happened? The child and all of Arjuna's arrows, everything disappeared. And the Brahmana came and said, "I came and believed you. After, keeping aside all Krishna, Balarama, all those people, I believed you. I am a fool." Like this the Brahmana said. So then Arjuna thought, what has happened? So Arjuna got very, he has given a vow to the Brahmana. He cannot break his vow. A Kshatriya cannot break his vow. So he said, no, I'll find out where your son is and I'll get him back. And immediately he took his chariot and then he started traveling. He went to Indraloka, he went to Brahmaloka, he went to Yamaloka. And he went up to Brahma's planet, up to Brahmaloka. There also he could not find the sons of the Brahmana. And then he went to Rasatala, Patala, everywhere, all the planets he traveled. But he could not find the Brahmana's son. Finally, Arjuna was frustrated. He came back and he said, I could not find your son. So as per my vow, I am going to kill myself. So he started organizing to sit in yogasana and immolate himself. He started preparing. All this while Krishna was silently watching. What is happening? Let us see the fun. Then when Krishna saw that Arjuna is going to kill himself, immediately Krishna came, hey, wait. I am there now. Why are you doing all these things? So this is what happens, you know. Devotees of Krishna, they will go and take some, you know, vow or some big endeavor they will take up. And finally, they will not be able to do it. Then Krishna will be forced to come and fulfill that vow. So Krishna said, "Arey, why did you take up this vow like this? Chalo, anyway, you have taken up this vow to protect you. Come with me." So Krishna, because Krishna knew what was happening behind the scene, this death of all these sons of Brahmana were not ordinary. It was not being done by some demon or something like that. If it was some demon and all, Krishna would have immediately killed all of them. So Krishna was keeping quiet because there was some reason behind that. So Krishna said, come. He put Arjuna in his chariot and Krishna's personal chariot, which was drawn by four horses. Four horses, they were all transcendental horses. Because Krishna is transcendental, his chariot is also transcendental. His horses, Shaibya, Sugriva, Megapushpa, Balahaka, they are all transcendental. So all these, with all these horses, Krishna started traveling. And he is driving the chariot and he is going. All the Saptadvipas crossed. They came to the edge of the universe. And then Krishna penetrated even the covering of the universe. You know, there are seven different layers. Earth, water, fire, all these things. Each layer is 10 times bigger than the previous layer. So, and it is very dark. So to light the way, Krishna sent his Sudarshana Chakra and then the chariot crossed over and they came to Viraja. And when they came to Viraja, they went to the middle of Viraja. There was a beautiful palace with all made up of jewels and glittering with lot of opulence and surrounded and lot of servants running around and all those things. And in the middle of the palace was Ananta Shesha with his thousands of hoods. And on Ananta Shesha's soft white body was lying Mahavishnu. So Krishna and Balaram, Krishna and Arjuna came in front of Vishnu. And the moment they came in front of Vishnu, Arjuna was seeing all this. He was completely awestruck, and he started, you know, feeling very fearful inside. Where have we come? What is this I am seeing? I have never seen anything like this in this world. Because the Mahavishnu's place on the Karanodaka is outside this material universe. There is nothing that can compare to the abode of Mahavishnu within this material universe. So Arjuna was completely awestruck and he did not know what to do when he came in front of Mahavishnu. So immediately Krishna, to show Arjuna what has to be done, Krishna offered his obeisances to Mahavishnu. Immediately Arjuna saw, oh, Krishna is offering, so I should also offer. So he also offered. Then when Krishna and Arjuna got up, then Mahavishnu, he immediately greeted Krishna and Arjuna. And then Mahavishnu told Krishna, Dvijatmaja me yuvayor didrukshana mayopanita. Vishnu told Krishna, this Dvijatmaja, all the sons of these Brahmanas, mayopanita, I only have brought them here. Why? Yuvayor me didrukshana, because I wanted to have darshan of both of you. And he said, Bhuvi Dharma Guptaye, both of you have incarnated on this material planet for Dharma Guptaye, for protection of Dharma. And further, not only that, Kalavatirnav Avaner Bharasuran Hatveha. You have Kalavatirnav with all your expansions and incarnations together, Krishna, you have incarnated, you have appeared on this avaner, on this material earth, on this prithvi, for what? Bharasuran hatva, for Because all the asuras have increased the burden on the earth with their asuric adharmic activities, you have taken birth to kill all of them, to annihilate all of them. If you remember, in the beginning of the Krishna book, in the beginning of the 10th canto of the Srimad Bhagavatam, the descent of Krishna, how does it happen? Because Mother Earth starts going to Brahmaji, crying that the burden on me has increased too much because of all these asuric kings. So, and then Vishnu tells Brahma that soon Krishna is going to appear to alleviate this burden. So Vishnu reminded Krishna of that you and Arjuna have incarnated with all your expansions for relieving the burden on the earth because of these asuric kings. Bharasuran hatveha twarayetam antime. So please finish your work quickly and come back to the spiritual world. So in this context, Prabhupada comments that what happened was Vishnu yuvayor didrukshuna. Vishnu wanted to have darshan of Krishna and Arjuna. Because why? Krishna doesn't come to this material universe often. He comes only in one day of Brahmaji. So it is very rare to get darshan of Krishna. Because Vishnu is always in this material universe, he also doesn't get to see Krishna. So when Krishna appeared in this planet, he thought, good opportunity, I should have his darshan. So he could have gone to Dwarka and had darshan, no. But no, Krishna's darshan is available only to whom Krishna chooses. Krishna had not yet chosen to give his darshan to Vishnu. So Vishnu could not have his darshan in Dwaraka. So he thought, how to have darshan of Krishna? I should do some trick by which Krishna will become forced to reveal himself to me. So therefore, he started stealing all the sons of the Brahmanas. But Krishna knew what was happening. Krishna knew what was happening, and he knew that Vishnu is wanting to see me, and therefore he is doing all this. So he didn't bother. But then when Arjuna's life came into question, Krishna said, "Arey, what is this? Chalo, I'll take you also, and I'll give my darshan to Vishnu and bring back the sons of Brahmanas." And then Vishnu gave back the sons of the Brahmanas to Krishna and Arjuna. Arjuna brought back those sons and handed them over back to the Brahmana. So what this means is, even Vishnu is anxious to have darshan of Krishna. And even he cannot have darshan of Krishna without Krishna's permission. That is the position of Krishna, the supreme position of Krishna, where even Vishnu becomes attracted. Because why? Because such a sweet beauty of Krishna, Vishnu also wants to have darshan. And he's so anxious, he's stealing away all the sons of Brahmana. To that extent, Vishnu is going. Vishnu is what? Namo Brahmanya Devaya. He is the worshipable lord of all the Brahmanas. He is always anxious to protect the Brahmanas. And that Vishnu himself is taking away all the sons of Brahmana and is putting that Brahmana into distress. Why? Because he is so anxious to see Krishna. That is Krishna's beauty. The sweetness of Krishna's beauty. It's not that Vishnu is not beautiful. Is Vishnu some ugly person? No. He is also so beautiful. He is compared to the lotus, Pundarikaksha. He has eyes like lotus flowers, lotus petals. So even he is very beautiful, but still Krishna's beauty has got a special sweetness to it. So this sweetness of Krishna's beauty is described by Bilomangal Thakur in the Krishna Karanamrita. He says Krishna's beauty, there are three aspects of Krishna's personality which are very sweet. Krishna's beauty, three aspects of Krishna's beauty which are very sweet. It is described as sweet, sweeter and sweetest. So in the Krishna Karanamrita, Bilomangal Thakur says, Madhuram Madhuram Vapurasya Vibhor. He says, Vapuhu, the body of Krishna is very beautiful, and that beauty of Krishna's body, Krishna's transcendental body, is very sweet. Madhuram Madhuram Vapurasya Vibhor. And then that is the sweet aspect of Krishna. Krishna's bodily beauty is sweet. Now there is something sweeter than that. What is that? Madhuram Madhuram Vadanam Madhuram. So first, Krishna's body, describing Krishna's beauty of Krishna's body, Bilamangal Thakur used the word Madhuram twice. Madhuram, Madhuram, Vapurasya Vibhor. Then when it comes to Vadana, the face, lotus face of Krishna, Madhuram, Madhuram, Vadanam, Madhuram. Three times he uses the word Madhuram. That Krishna's lotus face is sweeter. Then there is something which is sweetest. What is that? So, Madhuram, Madhuram, Vadanam, Madhuram. Madhugandhi Mridusmitam Yetadaho Madhuram 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 Madhuram. Four times he uses the word Madhuram Madhuram to describe Madhugandhi Smitam. Madhugandhi Smitam, the Krishna's soft, gentle smile. That has Madhugandhi. It has the fragrance of honey. And that smile of Krishna is the sweetest aspect of Krishna's beauty. And so that beauty of Krishna is so, it is so sweet that it is unmatched by the beauty of anything else, including the beauty of Narayana in Vaikuntha. And because of that sweetness of Krishna's beauty, all his devotees in Braja, all the Brajavasis, they are also, their love for Krishna is also imbued with that sweetness. Imagine every day they are seeing that sweet form of Krishna, the sweeter face of Krishna, and the sweetest smile of Krishna they are seeing every day. What will happen to them? They will all go mad in love. And that's what you see in the Brajavasis. They are all mad in love of Krishna. So much so that they cannot tolerate even one second. Even forget second, even a fraction of a second, when the eyelid closes, they cannot tolerate that. That we want to see Krishna constantly and look at the Creator, he has put eyelids which keep blinking. What is this? We are not able to see Krishna. This is the complaint of the Brajavasis. So this is the transcendental sweetness of Krishna, which is not to be found anywhere else. So the devotees of Krishna, because they are attracted by the sweetness of Krishna, the devotees of Krishna are also sweet and soft and gentle. They are not interested in making steel-like bodies, unlike the asuras. Because the asuras are devoid of that sweetness, or rather they have forgotten that sweetness, that sweet Krishna prema they have forgotten. Because of that, their hearts have become like steel, and therefore they take pleasure in building up their bodies like steel, and they feel this is the success of life. This is the unfortunate situation of all the asuras or the non-devotees of Krishna. So we should not be attracted by the display of opulence by the steel-hearted asuras. Actually, when a devotee sees these displays of opulence by the steel-hearted asuras, the Vaishnavas only feel sorry for them. They feel pity for them. They are missing the sweetness of Krishna's love, Krishna's beauty they are missing. And what is it that they are missing? Such a wonderful, sweet thing they are missing. What can be more pitiable? So devotees take pity on the asuras, and they are not carried away by the display of opulence by all the asuras. On the other hand, they are always immersed in the beauty and the sweetness of Krishna's beauty, and that drives them to be always dedicated to the lotus feet of Krishna. So these are some of the points that we can understand from this verse of the Srimad Bhagavatam. So if there are any comments or questions, we can discuss. So we'll stop here. Grantharad Srimad Bhagavatam ki. जगद्गुरु शील प्रभुपाद की निताय गौर प्रेमानंदी।